election day today. I'm sure people are all desperately busy to do other things as well. I have a few preliminary remarks to make. Fire alarm. If the fire alarm goes off, they mean it. There's no practice today. No smoking in this building. Toilets are down the corridor. Should anybody need to leave the meeting, you need to switch off all the equipment, and also please be aware of any confidential papers. Recordings. The meeting, it looks as though, is going to be recorded. If anyone has a problem with that, please let me know. Again, mobile phones, if you would switch those off. I'm Councillor Lesley Byrom, chairman of this meeting, and I declare the meeting open, and the recording may now start. So, we've got a couple of announcements just to make. We've had the local elections. Many of us, including myself, will remember with fondness. Fortunately, as a result of that, we've lost Councillor Sullivan, Councillor De Asher, and Councillor Allen. We will invite them to come back to the all those that weren't standing as well. We invite them to come back at the AGM, and we'll make a presentation and do the usual thing to thank them for their time on the authority. Those that remain on the authority, we have found, remain as ambassadors for the work that we do here, back in their own authorities for years and years to come. Those that have had an experience on the authority generally find it to be a good one. And we thank those who are here today, but you know, it's the end of their term for all that they have done. And again, please take those messages back to your own authority. Apologies. We received apologies from Councillor Brennan, who is now the Lord Mayor. Are there any other apologies anyone would like to mention? Declarations of interest. Any declarations of interest on the items on the agenda? There are no matters of urgency, and I don't think there's any exempt information on here. So, we're going to go to the agenda paper itself. Minutes of the previous meeting. That's circulated there. Is it agreed that I will sign that in due course? Indeed, I will do. So, we now move on to the corporate risk register, appendix item 3, pages 23 to 86. Chief.
Thanks, Chair. Purpose of the report to inform members of the current risks contained in the corporate risk register, the state of those risks and associated control measures that have been put in place to mitigate against those risks in the covered period from December 18 to March 19. The recommendation specifically is that members approve the updated community risk register subject to that review. The bit that I would draw members' attention to is on page 24, which talks about couple of new risks, or certainly one which has been removed, new risk being related to the way in which we record incident data. The Home Office designed a database which is described as the incident recording system. In dialogue we've had with the Home Office over the course of a number of months now, there is question mark over how that data system is going to be refreshed, when it's going to be refreshed, and the implications to ourselves. So certainly myself and Deb Appleton have been looking at, you know, the arrangements that we can put in place to mitigate that risk, but that risk is specific and contained within the updated risk register. And then element 7 of the report, then it looks at the risk related to the new fire station at Sorgo Massey, and members will be aware that they've took control of the building now. The fire station has gone live, and as such, that action has been discharged, and as a result of that, there's no further risk related to the particular build of that station, and it becomes business as usual. As you go through the corporate risk register itself, I've just highlighted a couple of small matters which I think are worthy of members' consideration. Based on the audit, internal audit report some time ago now, we introduced a risk appetite by strategic corporate risk categorisation, which was one of the specific actions that we were taught to do. As a result of that, I was refreshing authority members on the statements that Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority has an overall conservative risk appetite of the organisation will act in accordance with its with yes. this to achieve strategic objectives and deliver high quality fire and rescue services to the people of Merseyside within a framework of a reducing budget provision. And that remains the same. All that would suggest is, as we've looked at possible changes around our integrated risk management plan now, you will have heard me talk about the position of risk across the organisation and the potential to take a little bit more risk around financial arrangements to release resources to the front line. And again, we're talking to you about that risk at the time, so that being calculated low risk, but certainly improving the response and the number of frontline staff available to the authority. That then just goes some way to address some of the risks a little further if subject to the consultation process that's approved, and it related to the management and maintenance of a workforce, some of the financial challenges that we've faced with seeing the workforce reduce over a period of time, and that ability to manage financial risk a little differently has the potential to allow us to grow the number of people in the organisation far from what we've described as 620 to 642, but recognising that 20 plus individuals in training at any particular point in time, and that's referenced within the corporate risk register too. The other issue that I would again reinforce part of our changing plans, subject to that approval from the authority and the public consultation, is the investment in protection. And again, within the risk register, it identifies risks around protection, which I'll get to when I find the page, which is on page 26 and 27, which is page 53 of the report as you see it, which talks about the potential to recruit more individuals into protection roles. Again, it's contained within the IMP supplement, so increasing those numbers, which again will address some of the concerns of the danger and hacker review. Other than that, members, the risk register is as previously shared. Other than the issues that I've identified, I'm happy to take any specific questions as before.
Councillor Makinson.
Thank you, Chair. A couple of questions. Firstly, page 41, particularly relevant today, of course. Obviously, this heading office does need to be changed. We didn't leave in March, but we obviously now have to look forward to the 31st of October. But I caught a meeting late last year when last time we discussed this. There was mention of actual work, this work had been done. There'll be a briefing note just outlining some of the risks that are there, the sort of supplies that we could be at risk of being jeopardised on the effects that would have. I'm just wondering if that could perhaps be done.
Absolutely. My work is in progress, and given the timeline keeps changing, some of the kind of risks have arisen and dissipated, then arisen again and dissipated. But that work is available, so we can provide feedback in relation to the impact of the exit on the basis of our risk authority.
Thank you. And secondly, on page 61, on the issue of water main mapping, excellent piece of work to be doing. Just going to be following that very detailed presentation we had on the King's Dock fire and the issues that there were around the water availability and the single water main in that area. I'm just wondering if this mapping could also be used to look at the high risk areas, and particularly in terms of when United Utilities are doing renewal work, we could perhaps feed in there and try and influence where things could be improved in that way.
Absolutely, again, part of ongoing work that in regards to those relationships we've already struck, and we have the ability to do on mobile data terminals on our fire engines to be able to map all of the kind of the names. The example you gave around the Liverpool in a car park fire, yes, there's knowing and understanding the kind of disposition of those mains allows us to access the correct ones to get the most amount of water onto those relationships struck. That information is shared quite regularly. We do continue dialogue around areas which we come across where there's low water pressure and highlight some of those issues.
terms of particularly dealing with getting into planning applications for major developments around the docks, perhaps we could look at asking for risers to be installed in the docks so we could actually make use of that water and not have the same issues that we did have with the arena car park fire.
Yeah, we'll take that up as a consideration, and certainly the recommendations from the authority in relation to the new build of the new car park, sprinklers are included in that particular new build, so we'll continue to hold that dialogue. And for members who are awareness around local plans and the likes, we are consulted around kind of the key issues being water supplies and firefighting and means of access and egress from any particular area, so that again, that the processes are in place, but I think the suggestions and obviation on ourselves and have the opportunity of taking we would do so with comments on that.
Any other colleagues? I think at the LGA there's quite a lot of work going on about the upshot of the Grenfell Tower, and I would hope that the outcome of that would be that many of the safety messages that the fire authority has been left behind in terms of the statutory consultee on planning and development and building control will actually be reversed, because there are, you know, much of the Albert Dock area is new, and if only they put in better sprinklers and other provisions, okay, there's a car park, but there's lots of buildings there that would be safer if they could listen to the messages that we were sending out. We shall see. Any other comments on the corporate risk register? If not, would that report be agreed and received?
Agreed.
Thank you. Item 4 is approved exemptions to contract standard orders, pages 87 to 94.
Thank you, Chair. Members, this report is, as the Chair said, about contract standing orders, and really to advise members about the approved exemptions to those that were in 2018-19. We have to keep a register of contract standing order exemptions, and those go through quite a stringent procedure for approval. They can only be approved, as the report suggests, if it's not efficient or economic to comply with them. Examples of that kind of thing you'll see on page 5 of your report, where it's a unique service where there's no reasonable alternative, where you might have an existing contract that's got provision to extend it, or you're repeating the services that are already being provided, where you might be getting goods or services as a partial replacement of the ones you've already got, or where Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority might be part of a bigger consortium or collaboration, and we do that together. And so in 2018-19, you'll see that 55 exemptions were approved, and the reasons for those are outlined at Table 1, which is on page 88 of your papers. And you get a more detailed breakdown of that at page 91, which is where Appendix A is. On page 89, you'll see on the table there that it's all broken down to various departments where exemptions have been approved. And you might note, if you were looking down there, that National Resilience Training seems to be one of the higher areas. In fact, 6 out of those 9 exemptions approved for National Resilience Training were for other fire and rescue authorities. And what we're going to do, and you will see at the AGM, in contract standing orders, we're proposing to revise those to accommodate that so that we don't have to keep approving those exemptions for something like that over and over again. It's fallen, however. We only have 55 in 18-19, whereas the year before we had 125. So we've put quite a few contracts in place just to stop that from happening. So members, this report's asking you to note it. However, I am happy to answer any questions if anybody has any.
Thank you. Any questions on this report and item? Okay. Can that be noted and agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Well, this is the last meeting of this municipal year, the fire authority. So my thanks to all the members of the fire authority, those here and not here. It's been a difficult year at times, so thank you very much for all the help and support that you've been able to give. And also, all of us would want to give our thanks for all the help and support that our firefighters and our fire stoppers have been able to give to keep this community and the whole of the North West and the whole of England and the whole of the UK safer than they otherwise would have been. Thank you very much.